I would like to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Niamat Hegazi from Alexandria University. She's going to talk about adjuvant treatment of intermediate risk cervical cancer patient, and she's going to try to answer the question, can we do more? It's the floor for you. Yeah,
okay. مساء الخير لحضراتكم جميعا. It's an honor for me to be present with you. I am Niamat Hegazi, Associate Professor of Clinical Oncology, Alexandria University, Egypt, and I am one of board members of the Egyptian Gynae Oncology Society. Now, as most of us, I am clinical oncology, so always come after the surgeon. How can give the treat the patient after surgery with adjuvant treatment of intermediate risk cervical cancer? Can we do more or not? As all we know, the cervical cancer is the fourth most common cancer among the women. And unfortunately, in the developed country, due to absence of vaccination and the screening problem, we have most of our cases are locally advanced patients. So to find patients with early stage cervical cancer is almost rare. And because the limited access to this preventive measure of cervical cancer due to, as I said, absence of any vaccination and the screening problem. So the high mortality rate from cervical cancer can be reduced by this effective intervention at different stage. And the treatment mainly of cervical cancer based on the FIGO staging. So this is a treatment summary for the most of the cases, either from stage 1 to stage 2 and even up to the stage 4. So we now speaking about the early stage. So we're speaking about stage 1A up to the stage 2A2. And this based on the new FIGO staging. However, the most of the studies speaking about adjuvant therapy are speaking about the old FIGO staging, since before 2019. So what should we do with micro-microscopic disease, tumor confined to the cervix, or tumor invaded to upper to third of vagina? In the patient diagnosed with early stage with either lymphovascular invasion, 1B1, 1B2, and 2A1, not wishing to preserve the fertility, the main or standard treatment till now is a radical hysterectomy with assessment of the lymph node. After surgery, we should take in some of histological factors and also the clinical examination before surgery to decide our treatment. What's the next step? The patient comes to you with a histopathology and asks you what I should do. Should I carry on follow-up? Or I should to receive further treatment. In the microinvasive squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix, what is a post-operative mortality? As we see, this is a one of the trials that is published in 2003, including more than 2,000 patients with either stromal invasion less than 1 millimeter, with the risk of lymph node metastasis is just 0.1%. So there is no need of adjuvant treatment in this setting. Again, among of these patients, if the patient has a stromal invasion more than 3 millimeter, only we have 5 patients will develop only the metastasis. So the rate of the recurrence in this setting or group of patients is just 1.7%. So we come to second question. If the patient has early stage, go for surgery or go for radiotherapy. We have randomized a study of radical surgery versus the radiotherapy for early stage, stage 1B up to stage 2A, but this is all the classification. And we found that we have the similar overall survival. The 5-year survival is equal for the both. And almost, but in this trial, about 50% of this patient will receive adjuvant radiation. So this trial is actually not direct comparison between surgery alone or radiotherapy alone. However, if the patient after surgery has positive lymph node or has positive margin, or if the tumor more than 2B, this patient will receive adjuvant radiotherapy. Again, we have another trial that is published 2009 that compares the radical hysterectomy versus the radiotherapy, and this trial will include the patient with a stage 1B1 and stage 2A, and the conclusion included that if the patient has a tumor less than 6 meters, there is no difference between the surgery and the radiotherapy. However, in the radiotherapy arm, we have 50% of this patient will receive adjuvant radiotherapy. So regarding the surgery or the radiotherapy, till now we don't have accurate randomized trials that compare directly the surgery with the radiotherapy in 1B or 2A. So the preference of one regimen above the other mainly depends on either patient factor, patient fertility, institute, surgical, radiation oncology, and general condition of the patient. And this type of the surgery that should be done in this either early stage include type A radical hysterectomy, type B1, B2, C1, and C2, and finally type D radical hysterectomy. So in actually the most of the patient with early stage, the surgeon will take the upper hand. They start with the surgery first. But please, if the surgeon decided that this patient will go for upfront surgery, we have certain factors that will contribute to treatment failure in the early stage. What's this factor? Number one is cervical cancer or cervical tumor more than 4 centimeters. More than 4 centimeters, it depends on preoperative examination, not on the histopathology examination. And again, if the patient associated with 5-fold increase in the pelvic lymph node metastasis, 10-fold increase in the recurrent, and 15% decrease in the survivor. Again, we have review of the stage 1B squamous cell carcinoma, depending on the choice of the treatment, presence of lymph node alone after the radical hysterectomy associated with a poor survivor. If the patient has lymph node negative, the 5-year overall survival from 80 to 90%. However, if the patient has lymph node negative positive, the 5-year survival will drop markedly to 38 versus 61. And if the patient done upfront surgery, we classify the patient after surgery into either low risk, intermediate risk, and the high risk group. Based on what? Based number one on tumor size, if the tumor less than 2 centimeters or tumor more than 2 centimeters, based on lymphovascular invasion, if the patient has positive or negative lymphovascular invasion, based on again the stromal invasion, has just the invasion of inner one-third or any of invasion, and what the type of surgery. This is very important. We need to ask, or the surgeon should give to us, what the type of surgeon he did. He did type 1, B1, or B2, or even C1. Then our talk actually will present today about what adjuvant therapy in the intermediate risk group. What is the intermediate risk group? We actually intermediate risk group for a long time based on CEDLS criteria, which is old criteria. This criteria is mainly based on the lymphovascular invasion, stromal invasion, and the tumor size. The patient have either negative lymphovascular invasion with deep or middle one-third with a tumor size more than 4 centimeters. But if the patient has positive lymphovascular invasion, it should be have either stromal invasion, middle or deep or one-third, or patient have the tumor between 2 to 5 centimeters. This is an intermediate risk group. And this actual criteria was developed based on the prospective GOG trial. This included 500 patients with squamous cell carcinoma treated with radical hysterectomy and lymphadenectomy, and it was found this factor associated with increased risk of 3 years recurrent from 2 up to 31%. So this factor actually based on one of the old trial. Subsequent, the GOG need to validate this factor and then started to do what is called randomized trial. This compare radical hysterectomy. After radical hysterectomy, if the patient has intermediate risk factor, go either to follow up versus to receiving adjuvant radiotherapy based on what is called CEDLS criteria. And this was published and it was found presence of one of the following, either lymphovascular invasion, deep stromal invasion, large tumor site, it will be increase the risk or probability risk of the recurrence from 2 up to 30%. And the eligible patient, as I said, it has one of 4 combination factor, either stromal invasion, lymphovascular invasion, tumor size, and the patient will randomize it either pelvic radiotherapy versus no radiotherapy group, 15% in radiotherapy group versus the double 30% in the no versus group developed cervical recurrence. And the recurrence rate at 2 years, it was 88.1 versus 71%. And however, there is no significant of survival at this time. Then Roman, after that, published the long-term follow-up of this study that compares the patient after radical hysterectomy have intermediate risk factor, randomized either again to observation versus adjuvant radiotherapy, and this is the inclusion criteria. And it was found in the radiotherapy arm, the risk of the recurrence is 21% versus 38%. So the double of the risk of the recurrence, it will be doubled without any adjuvant therapy. And what the site of the recurrence, mainly in the vagina, either in the pelvic lymph node. And this is the risk of the recurrent. However, it was found the risk of recurrent reduced markedly, but almost 45% in the radiation groups. What about this? There is no significant difference at the survival at this time, because actually the trial is not powered to give the survival, overall survival. And what about the side effects? Most of the patient, of course, in radiation arm, it has some of the toxicity due to the radiotherapy. So the adjuvant radiation was associated with 12% absolute reduction in the risk of the recurrence. In long-term follow-up, patient treated with post-operative radiotherapy has continued decrease in the risk of the recurrence with significant effect on the overall survival. The benefit of adjuvant radiotherapy in reduction of recurrence mainly in the patient with adenocarcinoma or adenosquamous carcinoma. So the current guideline of management of cervical cancer proposed the adjuvant therapy after radiation therapy if the patient has one of three following criteria: positive lymphovascular invasion, deep stromal invasion, and the tumor size more than 4 centimeters. Again, the NCCN guideline also adds some of the additional prognostic factor like the tumor histology if the patient have adenocarcinoma and also close and positive margin. We have long-term follow-up data, which is a meta-analysis that's published 2012. This meta-analysis, again, this compares the radiation and the chemoradiation after surgery for intermediate risk group. And in this meta-analysis, it confirms the same, that there is reduction of the disease recurrence as a 5 years with the radiation versus no radiation, and no difference in the rate of the survival. But this is an important step we need to remember. The risk of the recurrence is more frequent if the patient has either positive lymph node, involvement of the parametrial, positive margin, or if the patient have largely and deep invasive cancer. The risk of the recurrence is almost found that it went up to reaching to 50 up to 70% of these patients will develop the recurrence. So we have this study that is published again, the value of adjuvant whole pelvis in the patient after radical hysterectomy, and this it was retrospective study. It was found the patient with positive pelvic lymph node, the adjuvant radiotherapy has decreased the risk of the recurrence with no improvement in the overall survival. And this is another prognostic factor we should be taking when we're seeing the histopathology of this patient. We have three new prognostic factors should be evaluated if the patient has intermediate risk group. One of that is called the tumor budding. What the mean of the tumor budding? Tumor budding is the mean presence of cluster of the tumor cell detaching from the invasive margin of the primary tumor. And if the patient have high tumor budding, more than 5 per hour field, this associated with the worse prognosis and worse overall survival and recurrence. Again, we have what is called the tumor-free distance, which is measured on the MRI before the surgery, which is the minimum distance of uninvolved stroma between the tumor and the very cervical ring. When this distance becomes small, this is associated with the increased risk of the recurrence. And also, in recent cohort study, we have both adenosquamous and distant less than 3.5, this is associated with markedly increase in the risk of the local recurrence. Now, we're speaking now, so the adjuvant radiotherapy is indicated if the patient have any of the following or risk factor of intermediate risk group. Again, if the patient have new risk factor or if the patient has positive lymph node or the positive margin. But what about the concurrent chemotherapy with radiotherapy? It has role in adjuvant setting of cervical cancer or not? It was found the failure rate with radiotherapy alone in the stage 2B at almost 25 up to 50%, and in the stage 3, at higher risk. So the idea of concurrent chemo radiotherapy, we have three effects of this chemotherapy. We have either additive effect, that we enhance the cytotoxic effect of the DNA. We have synergistic effect that will be help inhibition of the repair of sublethal damage and increase the sensitization of the cells to the tumor. And we have another independent factor. So the idea of giving the concurrent chemo radiotherapy to increase the effect of radiation. But when we should add the chemotherapy in the adjuvant setting. We have this 13-year experience of the patient with a stage 1B, 1 and 2B after the radical surgery. In this found that if the patient has a FIGO stage 1B and 2B and receiving either adjuvant radiotherapy alone or adjuvant concurrent radiotherapy, we divide the patient into two groups, either high-risk group or the intermediate-risk group. The high-risk group, it was found, has improvement of both. We have improvement of here in the upper curve. We have improvement in disease-free, progression-free survival, and also we have improvement of overall survival when adding the chemotherapy to radiotherapy in high-risk group. In high-risk group, we have improvement of both, progression-free and overall survival. However, in the intermediate-risk group, we have just in downstate intermediate risk, we have just improvement of the progression-free survival. However, the overall survival will not improve, something like the radiotherapy alone. So the concurrent chemo radiotherapy resulted in decrease of the recurrence, 9% versus 39%, and the trend toward the improvement of the 5-year survival. In high-risk group, the adjuvant chemo radiotherapy was superior to radiotherapy alone regarding the recurrence-free and the progression-free survival and the overall survival. However, the intermediate-risk group, concurrent chemo radiotherapy was superior to radiotherapy alone with regard to recurrence-free and the progression-free survival. If the patient not only have one risk, if the patient have two or more risk factor of intermediate risk group. Among the patient with only one intermediate risk factor, no survival benefit of concurrent chemo radiotherapy, and again, no improvement in the progression-free survival. Again, we have more update and more long follow-up of this. We have 20-year experience of the post-operative radiotherapy in the stage 1B and the stage 3A cervical cancer with a patient with intermediate risk group. And it was found the concurrent chemo radiotherapy with carboplatin paclitaxel will improve progression-free survival and also decrease the distant relapse. What about the rethinking the use again of radiation and the chemotherapy? We have now combination of the three trial. We see the clinical pathological analysis of the three trial, GOG trial, SWAG trial, and the RTOG trial. And this trial including the patient with only intermediate risk group. And it was found beneficial benefit of adding the chemotherapy was not strongly associated with either patient age or histological type, but associated with the type, the size of the tumor, number of positive lymph node, and the parametrial extension. So when adding the concurrent chemo radiotherapy, it should be based on the tumor size, if the patient has positive lymph node one or two or more, and if the patient has parametrial extension or not. And it was found absolute improvement in 5-year survival with adjuvant concurrent chemo radiotherapy. However, the absolute 5-year survival at least benefit among this patient with one positive lymph node, and markedly if the patient has more than one positive lymph node. And again, the National Cancer Database improves the same, the patient have overall survival with adding the chemotherapy if the patient has positive lymph node. We have now GOG trial, which is actually a randomized trial. This randomized trial comparing dietary, the adjuvant radiotherapy versus the concurrent chemo radiotherapy in the stage 1 or stage 2A after radical hysterectomy and bilateral pelvic lymph node adenectomy. But this patient, as I said, have more than one intermediate risk factor. And what we found? We found the concurrent chemo radiotherapy is better than the radiotherapy and the follow-up in form of the cumulative progression-free survival. But regarding the free survival, we have improvement with the concurrent chemo radiotherapy. And also, especially if the patient has positive lymph node and more than two-thirds of cervical wall involvement. Regarding them, what the type of the radiotherapy we should we use? We have two types of radiotherapy. We have either external beam radiotherapy or we have what is called brachytherapy. When we give the brachytherapy after the radical hysterectomy. American Brachytherapy Society Consensus Guideline actually answers this question and they said that if the patient has less than radical hysterectomy, the type of surgery is very important for us. If the patient has less than radical hysterectomy, if the patient has close or positive surgical margin, if the patient has large deep invasive tumor, barometrium involvement, or extensive lymphovascular invasion. This is indication of adjuvant brachytherapy after the radical hysterectomy. So we conclude the adjuvant radiotherapy should be considered in the presence of combination of risk factor as a final pathology, including tumor size, lymphovascular invasion, stromal invasion. Adjuvant chemo radiotherapy should be indicated if the patient has metastatic positive lymph node or if the patient has macrometastasis or micrometastasis, positive margin and parametrial infiltration. And we need also just to remember most of the old trial is speaking about radiotherapy is speaking about all the technique of radiotherapy, just the 2D or boxy technique. However, recently we actually use a more advanced technique of the radiotherapy like conformal and like IMRT. The IMRT for surgeon is the way of the the form of the radiotherapy that increase the dose to the target while at the same time trying to decreasing the dose of the normal structure, deliver multiple dose at one time, and also we can make what is called simultaneous infield post in case of the positive lymph node. So we try to solve this issue if the patient have either intermediate or the patient. And also we have update of seedless criteria. This update actually is very important to know because now the FIGO staging is completely changed. We have a change of FIGO staging in 2018. So it's very important if you're speaking about the stage two, which type of the stage two. Also we have different in the histopathological diameter. And also the tumor size measurement is very important to standardize it. Because in all the seedless criteria, it's based on clinical examination of surgeon before the operation. And this should be now standardized. And also we have advances of radiotherapy technique, as I said. And we have also speaking about the long-term toxicity and the side effect. And also the ASTRO guideline for the cancer cervix, it said that for women with cervical cancer and intermediate risk group, adjuvant radiotherapy is recommended to decrease the risk of local recurrence. And it's very important if the patient has positive lymphovascular invasion plus 1/3 of the cervical stromal, lymphovascular invasion plus 2/3 and the tumor size more than 2, or lymphovascular invasion plus superficial and the tumor size more than 5, or no lymphovascular invasion but patient has deep stromal invasion plus the tumor size. In this case, the ASTRO is strongly recommend the adjuvant radiotherapy. And this just is a summary of available treatment. As I said, the cervical dysplasia, maybe you go for CIN and early disease, either go for surgery followed by the adjuvant treatment depending on the risk factor. And thank you very much for your attention.